Macmillan Audio presents Oona Out of Order by Margarita Montimore. Read for you by Brittany Pressley. Time heals all. But what if time itself is the disease? Wim Wenders and Peter Handke, Wings of Desire. Prologue. Oona stopped trusting the mirror years ago. After all, it told only a sliver of the story. This isn't me. I am not this woman. The mirror exposed time's passage, yes, but eclipsed her heart's true mileage. The lined face, the extra pounds, the hair chemically treated to hide its gray. Each year the body was hers, but her mind was out of sync with her reflection, always playing catch up, trying to rearrange the scrambled pieces of her life. It was nobody's fault she had met her future too soon. It should have been decades before she wore this funeral dress. Oona threaded the chain of her necklace through her fingers, sunlight glinting off the gold gears of the pendant's clockwork parts. At first, the lost years were agony, the instant loss unbearable. And when the stolen time was returned to her, it was rearranged, always something else taken from her, someone else. But life had a system of checks and balances, and the bad breaks were tempered with good fortune. Even on this bleak day, hidden delights waited to offset the sorrow. She just had to be patient, open. For Oona, the pendulum could swing either way. Next year, the face in the glass could be older or younger. It was the closest thing she could imagine to immortality, a game of existential roulette, even though the wheel would eventually stop spinning. I'll see them all again, eventually, and lose them all again. She tried to accept the mirror's current verdict, to look at herself here and now, to be here now. But today, when her loss was tremendous and threatened to engulf her, she allowed herself to step out of this moment and rewind to a brighter one. Her muted dress replaced with sequins, her bedroom swapped for a mirrored basement, a room brimming with music and color and light, a love like a supernova, a party like no other. I can still get it right. Someday, she would pick up the thread and return to the party. Not a do-over, only a disrupted continuation. No telling when. Someday. Are you ready? Part 1. The Party's Over. 1982. 18. Chapter 1. The party flowed with cinematic choreography. Plastic cups and beer bottles tilted back in a syncopated rhythm. Clusters of guests bobbed heads and danced to a new wave soundtrack, as if the floor were a giant trampoline, a ribbon of tipsy laughter running through the room. It might have been only a basement in Brooklyn, with mirrored walls and tan carpeting. But tonight, it was their Studio 54, their Palladium, their Danceteria. A group of 50 with the noise and energy of hundreds, most on their college winter break. They'd come to celebrate New Year's Eve and Oona Lockhart's 19th birthday. And they showed up in style, in leather and frills, spangles and mesh, eschewing subdued fabrics for ones that glistened, glimmered, popped with color. The looks flirted with glam, goth, new wave, and punk, even as those who wore them refused to be labeled as one thing. In the corner, Oona knelt beside the stereo, sifting through a crate of records. She paused to check her watch, an anniversary gift from her boyfriend, Dale. It had no second hand, which gave the illusion of time moving slowly, sometimes even stopping. A single black diagonal line bisected the silver face dotted with tiny black stars. 9:15 p.m. In less than 3 hours, it would be 1983, and she'd be a year older. She stood, a record in either hand, as Dale, tall and sleepy-eyed, favoring his Brazilian mother's golden complexion, curly pompadour gelled back at the sides, ambled over. The sight of him quickened her breath.
"Hey, gorgeous. What you got there?"
He pointed at the records. "I can't decide which one to play next. Yaz or Talk Talk?" Shoulders tight, she raised and lowered the records as if weighing them.
"I've never seen anyone look so serious about picking a record. It's adorable."
He gave her a quick peck on the cheek.
"How about I take over as DJ and you go dance? I'll play them both."
While she allowed him to take the records, her shoulders remained stiff. "Okay, I just need to bring down more napkins and ice."
"I'll take care of that too. Your only job is to enjoy the party."
A wink belied his stern tone. Suddenly, one floor up, there was a crashing thud and shatter. Everyone stopped dancing and gazed up at the ceiling. Was it a noisy intruder? Something thrown through a window? Oona and Dale rushed to the foot of the stairs.
"Stay here. I'll see what it is,"
Dale said to her.
"I'll come with you."
Forced assertiveness as a cold, dropping sensation overtook her. "Not again, please." He paused on the stairs, turned around.
"I'm sure it's nothing, but it'll make you feel better. I'll go find Corey to check it out with me."
"Found him," she pointed over his shoulder. At the top of the stairs, Corey's lanky frame was hunched over in dread, his black Liberty spikes casting geometric shadows on his face.
"Dude, I'm so sorry. I was showing off some dance moves for these girls and the rug got in my way. I fell on top of your coffee table and it, broke. Nobody's hurt, but I'm a dumbass. I'll clean up the mess, replace the table, promise."
Cowering behind Corey were two petite girls wearing too much mascara and lamé dresses like liquid metal. Dale thundered up the rest of the steps. As his chest puffed out with a slow, indrawn breath, Oona crept up behind him and touched his back. Finally, he sighed and said,
"Hey, it's not a real party until something breaks, right?"
He stepped aside, waved through Corey and the girls.
"I'll clean it up. Just try not to break anything else."
The contrite trio headed downstairs as Oona followed Dale to the kitchen. He grabbed a broom and dustpan and grumbled,
"The guest of honor shouldn't be doing cleanup. I can handle the mess."
"Let me help. I've barely seen you since the party started." She pulled a trash bag from under the sink.
"I know."
Softened by her kindness, Dale dropped his voice to a sexy husk.
"Good thing we saw plenty of each other earlier."
They shared a suggestive chuckle. "I think at one point, the mailman saw plenty of us too." She leaned in and nuzzled against his neck, breathed in his tangy scent of Dracar Noir and Depp hair gel. "Serves us right for leaving the curtains open."
"And still less embarrassing than your mother walking in on us last week,"
said Dale. "Oh, it got even more embarrassing after you left," she flinched, remembering. "Once she made sure I was still taking the pill, she offered to let me borrow her copy of The Joy of Sex."
"I love it."
Dale's booming laugh forced his head back. As much as she would have liked to join in, she could muster only a weak smile. Having a liberal mother had its advantages, but Oona would have preferred more boundaries. Her father, a banker, had provided those until she was 11. Weekly chores, study plans, limited TV time. but once he died, she'd had to set certain rules for herself, which left her mother, a flight attendant turned travel agent, in a role more friendly than parental. She often teased Oona about taking things too seriously, whether it was her college courses or band practice, or even her relationship with Dale, urging her daughter to be young and frivolous once in a while. As if you couldn't be serious about something and still enjoy it. As if being young meant being foolish.
"I have an idea,"
said Dale, dropping the broom and dustpan with a clatter. Running over the scales of her sequin dress, he teased the zipper down a few inches and murmured,
"How about we go upstairs?"
He kissed her exposed shoulder and walked his fingers beneath the hem of her dress, upper thigh.
"We could lie under the stars."
The stars he spoke of were indoors, his bedroom ceiling strung with a nest of cables and telephone wires he'd scavenged from his father's electronics store and splattered with phosphorescent paint, creating a three-dimensional cosmic effect. The first time Oona had seen that ceiling, it made her gasp in wonder. 2 years on, she still found it awe-inspiring, to say nothing of the man running kisses down her neck.
"Tempting, but it would be rude to the others."
Reluctantly, she stopped his hand from moving any farther up her leg. "With school and the band, it's been ages since I've seen anyone besides you, Corey, and Wayne."
"We saw a bunch of people at CBGB's just a couple of weeks ago."
"Yeah, but we were so busy playing the holiday showcase and meeting with Factory 12's manager, we barely got to talk to our friends."
"Considering what came of it, I don't think they minded. You know what a tour like this could do for our band? After opening for the Pretenders, Factory 12 got signed to Chrysalis, and their first single just hit the top 40.
"They're still not the Pretenders, though. I mean, it's not like we're going to be playing stadiums."
"Right."
The word drawn out as he took a step back, his eyebrow inching up.
"But we've never played for more than a couple hundred people. We've never even left the tri-state area. And Factory 12 could still become huge. Opening for their spring tour is the kind of break most bands never see. I thought you were excited about it."
"I am. I'm not.
She fought to keep a stammer out of her voice.
"It's exciting, but it's intimidating. Visiting new cities, playing bigger venues."
"It's more than that,"
he said with a knowing nod.
"You don't have to keep it from me, you know."
Her stomach plummeted. Did he know?
"Keep what from you?"
"You're still shaken up from the mugging after Wayne's party. I saw how you jumped at the crash earlier. You thought it was a burglar. And you're worried about touring, scared something bad might happen again."
"Oh."
Relief ran through her like a faucet turned up full blast.
"Well, it was pretty terrifying."
It happened last month, on the subway back to Bensonhurst. At first, she'd laughed at the man who'd approached them because he wore swim goggles, but she'd stopped laughing when he pulled a switchblade.
"Listen to me."
Dale's voice dove down a few notes as he pulled her in close.
"Nothing would have happened to you. I was ready to do whatever it took to keep you protected. Face a knife, a bullet, anything."
"Thank God all it took was handing over our money."
She shuddered, recalling how paralyzed she'd been, how Dale had to reach into her own coat pocket to remove her wallet and pass it to their goggled assailant. "And good thing I wasn't wearing my watch that night."
"Nothing bad will happen to you on this tour. As long as you're with me, you're safe."
The promise was echoed in his steady gaze and the determined set of his jaw. "I know." Her voice caught in her throat at his vehemence. "You don't have to take a bullet for me to prove it." She traced a finger over the bump in his nose.
"I'll also take a hammer if you want to straighten that out for me."
Despite his overall swagger,
His nose was the one part of his body he felt embarrassed by. Shush, I have the hots for your nose. And not just because of what they say about big noses. Una's hand hovered at his belt buckle, wanting to travel farther south, but remained still. It would be too easy to lose track of time. Let's go take care of this mess. But first, a little help? Draping her long, chestnut hair over one shoulder, she offered her exposed back so he could zip her up into the dress. Do you think we should have rehearsed more earlier?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.